Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. Now that we know about the strong law of large numbers that I proved in a previous video of this playlist, I'm going to tell you about another very popular and very important limit theorem in probability theory. This theorem is called the central limit theorem. You will see that this central limit theorem has something to do with some kind of deviation from the mean, and so that's some kind of natural complement and natural next step now that we know the strong law of large number. I'm also going to tell you in this video about large deviation estimates. That's another very important result in probability theory, but this result is much less popular. Now the reason why I'm telling you about this over result in this same video, it's because in the same spirit as the central limit theorem, large deviation estimates tell you again about some kind of deviation from the mean. So now it turns out that those two theorems, central limit theorem and large deviation estimates, are extremely difficult to prove, so I'm not going to do that in this video. In particular, their proofs are significantly more difficult than the proof of the strong law of large number, but at least I'm going to state carefully those two theorems, explain the statement, and more importantly, I'm going to motivate those theorems and explain why these are natural next steps after the strong law of large number. So it turns out that the context for those two theorems or assumptions are exactly the same as for the strong law of large number, meaning that we start with a sequence of independent and identically distributed random variables xi, and we are interested in the empirical mean of this sequence, so that means the sum of the first n random variable divided by n, and we want to study this quantity. So let me just remind you a little bit about, again, the context, the common context for all those theorems, and also the statement of the strong law of large number. So we start with a sequence xi of random variables that we assume to be independent and identically distributed. Okay, then a quantity of interest is Sn, that's the sum x1 plus x2 and so on up to Xn. And what the strong law of large number tells us is that Sn over n, that I call the empirical mean, so for each fixed n, Sn over n obviously is a random variable. However, it turns out that that's a consequence of the strong law of large number. As n increases, this random variable, I want to say, becomes less and less random, more and more deterministic, at the point that in the limit, this quantity does not converge to a random variable per se, that converges just to a fixed deterministic number that corresponds to the common expected value of those xi. So that's just to remind you the statement of the strong law of large number. So we have convergence to expected value of xi. I'm going to call this quantity mean. So that's the statement of the strong law of large number. So now let's look at the central limit theorem. Not the statement of the theorem, but the motivation. So central limit theorem. So, just to motivate this theorem, you see that Sn over n converges almost surely to mu, which means that Sn over n minus mu converges almost surely to zero, and so you can rewrite this also as Sn minus mu n, and you see that each of those random variables have expected value mu, so the expected value of Sn is indeed mu n. So this quantity is just the sum of the first n random variable minus the expected value of Sn. If we divide this quantity by n, okay, by the law of large number, this converges to zero. Okay, so this converges almost surely to zero. And so now a natural question is, by how much Sn is going to deviate from its mean? And a consequence of the strong law of large number is the fact that this convergence tells us that Sn is going to deviate from its mean mu n by a quantity that should be negligible compared to n. So the statement implies that, so the deviation is negligible compared to n, and the question is, what should be the correct rescaling here? Okay, what is the natural rescaling so that this limit is not degenerate? N is too much. Now, if you divide by something that is at the opposite too small, this limit here is going to be equal to plus or minus infinity. And so that's again degenerate. And so the question is, what should be, by what should we replace n to have a non-degenerate limit? And that's going to tell us something about the order of magnitude between Sn and its mean. So, I don't know, is it log n? Is it square root of n? Most likely that should be, like intuitively, that should be something that goes also to infinity, but that should not go to infinity as fast as n, that should go to infinity at a slower rate. So that's the motivation of the central limit theorem. The central limit theorem is going to answer this question. So now, second natural question, given by this over result, large deviation estimates. So now, another consequence of the central limit theorem is the fact that if we look at the probability that Sn over n is strictly larger or larger or equal to something strictly larger than mu or less or equal than something which is strictly less than mu, then we should have convergence to zero. So I'm going to look at the case where we have this empirical mean, let's say larger than something of the form mu plus epsilon, okay? And clearly, another consequence of the strong law of large number is that this probability goes to zero, okay? This probability goes to zero, and so now the large deviation estimates result tells us something about the rate of convergence here. Okay, the fact that we have convergence to zero is an obvious consequence of the strong law of large number. If n is large enough, then with probability very close to one, this empirical mean is going to be close to mu, and so it cannot be larger than mu plus epsilon. But the question is, how fast does this probability go to zero? Does it go to zero slowly, or does it go to zero very fast, like exponentially fast? And so that's kind of the motivation of those two theorems. So now let's look at the answers in the slide with like statement of the central limit theorem and statement of the large deviation estimate. So first, the central limit theorem tells us that the natural rescaling we are looking for is in fact equal to square root of n. That's by dividing Sn minus its mean by square root of n that we are going to have a non-degenerate limit. And more precisely, if we assume that in addition to have a finite mean, those random variable xi also have a finite variance sigma square, then by dividing Sn minus n mu by sigma times square root of n, we have convergence in distribution to the normal random variable with mean 0 and variance 1. So that gives us the answer to our first question here. The natural rescaling here should be square root of n, so that we have a non-degenerate limit, not 0 and not plus or minus infinity. And so I'm going to rewrite the theorem here. We know that if we divide by square root of n, we are going to have convergence in distribution to some other non-degenerate random variable. If I divide by something much less than square root of n, like for instance log n, then the limit is degenerate, that's equal to plus or minus infinity. At the opposite, if I divide by something that is much larger than square root of n, like n for instance, then we have limit zero. So here, to be more precise, we need to add a sigma here that corresponds to the variance, the common variance of all random variables. And now this becomes a convergence in distribution to the normal random variable with mean 0 and variance 1. Now, before we move on to large deviation estimates, I want to kind of rewrite this statement and like just also reminding you the definition of convergence in distribution and also the density function of this normal random variable. So by definition of convergence in distribution, we should have that the distribution function of this random variable should converge when n goes to infinity to the distribution function at the same point of the normal random variable with mean 0 variance 1. And so using this definition, we get eventually that another way to think of the central limit theorem is to say that let's say for all x in R, we are going to have that the probability that this random variable is less or equal to x, so should converge. Okay, that's the distribution function of this random variable at point x, should converge to, well, the distribution function of the, at also point x of the normal distribution. I remind you that the density function of the, normal distribution has a distribution function that is continuous. So we have convergence here for all x by definition of convergence in distribution. And then the probability that a normal random variable 0, 1 is less than x is exactly going to be the integral from minus infinity to x of the density function. Density function here is going to be 1 over square root of 2 pi times e to the minus t square over 2 dt. So you can state the central limit theorem in terms of convergence in distribution to a normal random variable with parameters 0 and 1, but that's exactly equivalent to this statement, and that's typically this statement that we used in application. So now let's look at the result for large deviation estimates. So the assumption of this result is the following. We need to assume that capital M of theta defined as expected value of E to the theta xi is finite for some theta strictly positive. This function capital M is called the moment generating function of the random variable xi because all the xi's are assumed to be identically distributed. They all have the same moment generating function. So now observe also that by definition of the moment generating function, M of zero, capital M of zero, is just equal to 1, which is finite. And so what this assumption tells us is that what we need is this moment generating function to also be finite or bounded, not only at zero, but in a small neighborhood of zero. That's in fact a very mild assumption, and most random variables in practice satisfy this assumption. Now, under those conditions, it can be proved that for all epsilon positive, there exists a gamma strictly positive, but that depends on epsilon, such that if you look at those two inequalities at the bottom, they basically tell you that the probability that the empirical mean, Sn over n, deviates from its theoretical mean mu by more than epsilon is going to be less than e to the minus gamma n. So eventually we can complete the picture here on the board. We saw that clearly an obvious consequence of the strong law of large number is the fact that this probability converges to zero. Now we have something better than that. Large deviation estimates tells you that at least for like most well-known random variable xi, in fact this is less or equal to e to the minus gamma n. So obviously this inequality tells us again convergence to zero, but now we have much more information. From the strong law of large number, we only knew that this probability goes to zero. We didn't know how fast. Now we know that this probability goes in fact to zero exponentially fast. So you have an exponential decay in n.